Okay, good evening. I think we'll make a start. So I'd just like to start off by saying welcome to the Dance Studies Colloquium, both to people in the room. If you've not been here before, I extend a really warm welcome to you. And also those who are joining us remotely who are coming in through the live stream as well. Just welcome to you this evening. Thank you for coming out. Just before I introduce our speaker this evening, I just want to remind everyone that November the 27th will be the last speaker for this semester. It's Dr. Ariel Osterweis, with her somewhat intriguingly titled talk, Prophylactic Aesthetics. So this evening, I'd like to welcome our speaker, Dr. Juliet McMains from the University of Washington. And just before saying a little bit about her publications, I just want to say something of the important contributions that Dr. McMains has made to dance studies as a field. At a time when dance studies had primarily focused on Western concert dance and almost sort of derided those dances that were done for pleasure or for popular entertainment, she really brought attention to what was described as ballroom dance sport and why we should take its practices seriously. And within this particular research, she considered both the diverse community of people deeply invested in the practice, its transnational movements, its proclivity for commodification, and how it really begins to complicate questions of race, gender, nation, and class. And I think what was so important about this work is she spoke very much from the position of an expert practitioner. Therefore, her work always comes from a place of nuanced, embodied knowledge and continues to do so. So with that said, in 2006, she published her first book titled Glamour Addiction Inside the American Ballroom Dance Industry, which won the Congress on Research in Dance's Outstanding Publication Award. And then in 2015, she published Spinning Mambo into Salsa, Caribbean Dance and Global Commerce. And she's published
a woman
many...
in her early 20s named Valentina. Her finely tuned sensitivity to subtle shifts in tone and direction, allowing her to react to my lead with minimal delay. She is an excellent follower, although she interprets this role quite liberally. Instead of always waiting to react to moves I initiate as leader, she frequently reverses the direction of a barrida or steals a gancho. All leaders are accustomed to having to follow the follower when cues are misread. But Valentina clearly understands my lead and deliberately contests it. She absorbs my lead and redirects it back at me in altered form, momentarily hijacking the lead and reversing our roles without reversing the embrace or the footwork. Her periodic challenge of my authority reminds me that her following is always an active choice. Valentina, who with a mischievous smile arrests my momentum mid-hero and reverses our turn, my acceptance of her suggestion also signaling my consent to the game, has turned a monologue into a playful dialogue. Granted, I still speak for the majority of the dance, but her interjections into the conversation significantly shape its direction. By the time the evening ends, I have danced with most of the women at the Milonga, alternating who leads every other song. Before the last tanda of the night, I finally catch the eye of Soledad Nani, the most well-respected female leader in the Argentine queer tango scene. Her lead is playful, clear without being overbearing, filled with unexpected changes of direction and astute musical interpretation. Soledad is also an exceptional follower, but even more unruly than Valentina. Soledad is so skilled at redirecting my lead that it unnerves me. Almost nothing I initiate concludes as planned, and I am not able to adapt to such rapid-fire exchange of roles. For Soledad, however, slipping between the roles of leader and follower, or conductora and conducida, the term Soledad prefers, comes as easily as Spanglish does to a bilingual speaker. She offers me a glimpse of what I have always imagined tango could be, a fluid exchange of energy and creativity where both partners take equal responsibility for shaping the conversation. I leave the milonga as it closes at 2 a.m., glistening with sweat and giddy with excitement. Although I am dancing the same steps and the same technique to the same music as I would at any other milonga in Buenos Aires, I leave Tango Queer feeling lighter, more cheerful, and more hopeful than I am at the end of a night at Salon Canning, Villa Malcolm, or La Viruta. It is only after tasting queer tango in Buenos Aires, the only city in the world with a large enough tango scene to, until recently, sustain queer-specific milongas several times a week, that I recognize how essential a queer-designated tango space is for the manifestation of queer tango's potential. I attended Tango Queer Weekly for 2 months in 2012 and again for 2 months in 2014, interviewed 48 women from Argentina, Europe, and North America who regularly danced tango with other women. Slightly over half my interviewees self-identified as straight or heterosexual, while the rest identified as lesbian, gay, queer, or bisexual. And this is the interactive part of the presentation. So if you dance tango and you identify as a woman, you're welcome to join me now.
I had a wonderful night, I had the dances, and then I realized, okay, at least tonight I was the only woman leaving.
I've never danced with either of these women before, and this is a very unideal dance floor. This carpet makes it extremely difficult to dance tango, so thank you so much to both of you and our shoes for helping me out there. So at milongas throughout the world and in Buenos Aires, it is now commonplace to see women dancing tango with other women. These women include queer tangueras, aligned with the queer tango movement, and a second phenomenon I call Rebellion of the Wallflower, in homage to the pioneering work of Marta Savigliano on tango wallflower, the woman who sits on the side of the milonga waiting to be asked to dance. Discontent to continue wallflowering, these women do not necessarily identify with or attend queer tango events, but practice, teach, perform, and social dance with other women when the mood or the situation suits them, without denying themselves the option of dancing the, quote, traditional woman's role with men. Granted, the majority of couples at most milongas are still male-female, but it has become acceptable and even routine to see women dancing together at prácticas, which are informal tango dances, and milongas in Buenos Aires. I have argued in a paper that just came out 2 days ago in Dance Research Journal that the growing visibility of same-sex dancing in Argentina is due to the confluence of four developments: the rise of tango commerce, the continuing influence of innovations enabled through Tango Nuevo, which you can read about in this excellent book written by Carolyn Merritt, who is here, changing laws and tourism related to LGBTQ communities, and the synergy between queer tango dancers and rebellious wallflowers. Today I'm going to focus on this final point. After spending a bit more time articulating what is so powerful about queer tango space, queer tango space offers many benefits to their patrons, including providing LGBTQ participants relief from minority stress, the effect of isolation and discrimination experienced in heterosexual spaces. For example, an American transgender dancer explained that in queer tango contexts,
I don't have to be on guard that someone's going to call me a name or look me up and down and, you know, make some snide comment, which happens, unfortunately. I've used the word already, but it's just so much more helpful not having to worry about that.
Many interviewees recounted microaggressions they endured in mainstream tango classes and milongas. For example, when it came time to rotate partners, female leaders described the humiliation of being skipped over or avoided by other female classmates, or being stared at when dancing at milongas. Although such instances were rare, the potential threat, coupled with the fact that many often endured hostile comments or stares in their daily lives, kept many queer women from feeling entirely at ease in hetero-tango contexts. In queer tango, dancers feel more secure that they won't be judged, criticized, or singled out due to their gender or sexual orientation. As American lesbian tango dancer explained, the queer label can be just as or more important for creating that safe environment as the sexual identity of participants.
Queer festivals and queer classes and queer teachers and this. If straight people come to an event labeled queer, you can even have overwhelmingly number of straight people, but if you label it queer, you know that they've come there with the mindset that will allow you to be all right.
In addition to relief from minority stress, queer tango spaces offer gay tango dancers a space in which they feel welcome to indulge in flirtation and courtship on the dance floor. This same American dancer explained.
When straight people go to the milonga and the dance, they're there, they're looking for the full expression of their being. They want to mate, either briefly on the floor, or in their heads as a possibility, or you know, out in the back alley, or at home later tonight with the old man.
Right.
That's a huge element in social dancing. It's huge.
Yes.
And the heterosexual community takes it for granted, so much so that they don't have to talk about it.
Right.
It's a silent object. We gather together to mate, and why not? It's fine. A queer festival, a queer tango festival, is someplace we can walk in and go, oh, everybody here is okay with me mating if I want to. You know, and it's okay for me to flirt with somebody. It's okay for me to have sex in the alley if I want to. It's okay.
Not only does she feel more welcome to nurture sexual energetic exchange with other women in queer tango contexts because of the non-judgmental environment, but the high concentration of lesbians at queer tango events makes flirtation more likely. She continues.
In this dance, you need to make yourself available fully. And that included the possibility that you could be seduced.
Mm-hmm.
You have to give that to your partner, right? Straight women don't often go there with other women. And they just don't. That's sort of the definition of who they are.
Because she rarely finds that straight women make their sexual energy available to other women while dancing, she prefers queer tango events where she is more likely to access tango's sexual dimension. Queer tango was never, however, conceived as an exclusively gay space. The dream of queer tango, like queer theory, was that it could help to destabilize and ultimately dismantle heteronormative categories of gender and sexuality, making way for an expanded spectrum of gender and sexual expression untethered from biological sex. Mariana do Campo's Tango Queer Milonga and weekly Tango Queer classes became a haven not just for lesbian women to learn to lead, but also for rebellious wallflowers. Do Campo's vision was to create a space where any individual could dance either role, irrespective of gender or sexual orientation, including straight women. Bolstered by their practice leading at queer milongas, many heterosexual women developed enough confidence leading to begin dancing with other women at mainstream milongas. The success of queer tango, therefore, could indirectly be credited with the facilitation, with facilitating relaxation of taboos on same-sex dancing at mainstream milongas. Women clad in dresses and high heels, following men the majority of the night, became stealth agents in a mission to interrupt tango's heterosexual embrace when they danced one or two tandas a night with their female friends. Women who appear to be abiding by codes of feminine behavior are less likely to be ostracized or insulted than women who appear dressed to usurp the male role in their slacks and flat shoes. Infiltration of female leaders at many milongas paved the way for acceptance of female leaders who presented a broader range of gender expression. In other cases, lesbian dancers were the pioneers. For example, Argentine Soledad Nani began studying tango in 2002. From the beginning, she studied both roles with maestros Gloria and Rudolfo Denzel. The Denzels are renowned for their distinctive pedagogical approach, which encourages everyone to learn both roles in classes, although at the time, none of their students were practicing open role dancing at milongas. When Nani began venturing out to milongas with her friends from class, she garnered considerable attention because she was the only woman leading, the only visibly identifiable lesbian at mainstream milongas in Buenos Aires, she recalls.
Toda la gente me miraba un montón, pero no me decían nada. Y
yo creo que también acá un poco me hice conocida por eso, porque no había mujeres bailando en las milongas. Y además que yo no fui nunca una mujer así más femme, si querés, ¿no? Era más un estereotipo más masculino, entonces eso llamaba mucho la atención, ¿no? Porque si vos conducís, que sos toda más femme, toda bonita, así, a los chicos un poco más les gusta, y un poco de la fantasía, ¿no? De que sean dos chicas. Pero cuando se ve a una lesbiana masculina, ¿no? Ese contraste.
Sí.
Others might have quit in the face of such discrimination, but Nani was not dissuaded by the negative attention and persevered. Gradually, she began to gain acceptance for her undeniable skill. Nani fought prejudice with excellence. Her dancing flows like water around rocks, powerful and steady, yet fluid and malleable, dexterously adapting to her partner and the music in a playful game with each. Nani was a pioneer, blazoning a trail for female leaders, inspiring gay and straight women around the world who witnessed her masterful command of tango's building blocks and ability to manipulate them in playful demonstrations of wit. She has also helped to challenge prejudices against female leaders at mainstream milongas, where she has earned acceptance thanks to her undeniable grit. Thus, Soledad Nani offers an example of how crossover between queer and mainstream tango helps to encourage the growth of female leaders in both spheres. Synergy between queer tangueras and rebellious wallflowers works bidirectionally. The public performance of several high-profile professional tangueras leading other women has helped to normalize female same-sex dancing. For example, many women I interviewed named Ariadna Navera, daughter of Tango Nuevo pioneer Gustavo Navera, as a key inspirational figure. Ariadna, who primarily tours, teaches and performs in the woman's role with her male partner, Fernando Sanchez, has been publicly leading other women at milongas and in performances since the early 2000s. In addition to performing with women, Ariadna regularly swaps roles with Fernando in performance, skillfully leading him into complex sequences. So watch for the change of the embrace here. Now she's leading. Now she gave the lead back, and he's leading. Like other femme female leaders, Ariadna is more easily accepted because she does it part-time in heels and a dress. The fact that she's a straight woman with an impeccable tango pedigree who dances the man's role better than most men undoubtedly played a role in how readily her unconventional behavior was accepted. Many straight women dance with other women in part, I suggest, because same-sex tango dancing offers them a way of exploring sensual and sexual intimacy with other women without pressure to identify as lesbian, bisexual, or queer. When asked to recall their first experience dancing with another woman, most straight-identifying women describe the shock of feeling another woman's breasts against theirs. American dancers Sonia, who leads and follows with equal skill and frequency, recalled with clarity her first breast-to-breast dance 10 years prior.
And I remember the first time I danced with a woman in close embrace, and I'm pretty sure she wasn't wearing a bra. And there was like these couple moments of like massive embarrassment as like our boobs touched.
The vividness with which she remembers her first contact with another woman's chest points to how uncommon it is for straight women to engage in such extended physical intimacy with other women. Same-sex tango offers women a play zone of sensual, maybe sexual, physical contact with other women. Sonia, who identifies as, quote, totally straight, regularly teases, "I make sweet, sweet love to all the women I dance with." Her flirtatious use of language reveals the way same-sex dancing can offer women a liminal space to explore ways of relating to other women that fall in a space between straight and gay. Another American dancer who identifies as straight and primarily dances in the role of follower was more explicit in linking her experience dancing with other women to sexuality.
Like, I think all of us, when we started leading the women, there's a certain amount of thrill about having somebody's breasts up against you, and I think we all, I think probably on some level, question our sexual identity.
Even if they did not describe the experience as sensual or sexual, many straight women were able to access a new kind of intimacy with women through the physicality of the dance. A European woman who learned to dance in the United States but started following other women while living in Argentina explains.
Before coming to Buenos Aires, I wasn't really comfortable dancing, but I always thought that you should dance tango with a man. And then, like, I remember, like, when Eric asked me, I was like, does Eric really want to dance with me? Like, why does she want to dance with me? And I'm like, okay, like, why not, you know? And then, like, I actually, like, I got that energy, like, really good, like, energy exchange with, like, all kinds of, like, different women that I danced with here. And then, like, I really don't even think it's so weird, and, like, I actually like it.
Believing that sexual tension was a fundamental aspect of tango, she had not even considered the possibility that she could enjoy dancing with women prior to making friends with several female leaders. Whether they identify their experience as sexual, sensual, or an enjoyable energy exchange, for many straight women, the physicality of boob-on-boob dancing is a means of discovering new kinds of kinesthetic relationships with other women. Because same-sex dancing among women has to a large extent become acceptable and in some locales commonplace, women are able to explore the edges of same-sex desire inside a structure that is sexually charged but not marked as homosexual. My own experience speaks to a more conscious engagement with sexual desire. I am a straight woman, mostly. My appearance is quite feminine. I wear dresses, lace, high heels, and makeup. I have mostly dated men, but I am also attracted to women. Very feminine women, women whose appearance and energy is even more feminine than mine. Tango offers me a means of holding a woman in my arms while she is expressing archetypal feminine qualities of receptivity, softness, and flexibility. Furthermore, my role as leader in this exchange is to entertain and protect her, invoking an archetypal masculine-feminine dynamic that I find strangely satisfying. I'm not saying that I feel sexual attraction to every woman I lead in tango, just as I don't feel sexual attraction to every man I follow. Nor am I suggesting that my experience is necessarily common. I offer it here as another example of how same-sex tango offers a zone to test out and play with same-sex desire within the structure of a dance that both invokes passion and controls its expression. Furthermore, growth of queer tango and the resulting presence of queer tango dancers engaging in same-sex dancing at mainstream milongas has helped to normalize female-female dancing at any milonga. So women don't need to go to a queer-identified tango space to enjoy dancing together. Thus, straight women can enjoy dancing with other women in a very sensual manner at a mainstream milonga and not risk being identified as gay. In other words, the knowledge that there is a queer tango space specifically designated to cultivate same-sex desire allows some straight women to feel safe to explore same-sex desire in straight tango contexts, whereas there is little expectation of sensual energy exchange between women in the dance, leading to a sexual encounter. Straight women who do attend queer tango events are able to pass as gay, bisexual, or queer without needing to label themselves as such, because to ask someone to declare their sexual orientation at a queer tango event is considered counter to the queer project itself. It is a Tuesday evening at Tango Queer in Buenos Aires when a tanda of Pugliesi, the most romantically dramatic of the classic orchestras, begins. I catch the eye of my partner of choice. Her flowing red dress captures the combination of boldness and softness she exudes. After a song, we begin the standard introductory banter. Where are you from? Sweden, Seattle. Do you know so-and-so? By the next break between songs, she is encouraging me to attend the Berlin Queer Tango Festival, where a mutual acquaintance met her wife, prompting a cross-Atlantic move from Sweden to San Francisco. Who knows? My dance partner chides without any hint of irony. You might come home with a Swedish wife. Then she slides her arm around my bare back and launches into a cross-system walk. As the driving force of Pugliese's bandoneons carry us, her words linger like the refrain of a newly discovered song. A wife. I had never before considered the possibility. I am thrilled both at her apparent assumption that I am gay and by the fantasy of coming home with a Swedish wife. In one sentence, she has doubled my future prospects in love. My internal sense of my own sexual identity momentarily shifts in response to the way I am perceived and treated by those around me. Queer tango space extending into my own psyche. While my reevaluation of my sexual identity was short-lived, other participants credited the queer tango environment as a key factor in enabling an enduring transformation of their own gender or sexual identity. For example, American dancer Allie, who came to Buenos Aires with her boyfriend, explains how being surrounded by gay women in the sexually charged queer tango environment gave her confidence and opportunity to more openly embrace her same-sex desire.
It was like before, we wanted to be a secret thing.
Through queer tango, she met several women with whom she had sexual encounters, seduction on the dance floor providing a convenient entree to its horizontal expression. Within a year of her extended stay in Argentina, she had stopped dating men and began to identify as a lesbian. Similarly, German dancer Alex Gastel, who identifies as genderqueer, credits moving to Argentina and immersing themselves in the queer tango subculture as that which enabled the shift from she to they. Alex explains, quote, I started to identify as neither woman nor man. I experimented with androgynous clothes, with a new name and haircut, and I loved it. Now what has queer tango to do with that? Dancing the leading role was my first big break with gender norms on a more bodily level. I discovered that I liked to mix traditionally male and female movements in both roles. That gave me the curiosity and courage to start playing with gender norms on the physical level outside of dancing too, end quote. For Alex, the opportunity to embody movements that were associated with both masculine and feminine and to fluidly switch between performance of such markers of gender identity on the dance floor was a catalyst for assuming more fluid ways of expressing gender identity off the dance floor. For both Alex and Allie, queer tango provided a safe space in which to experiment with new gender and sexual identities, giving each the confidence to assume new queer identities in their daily lives. The success of Buenos Aires Tango as an international hub for tango tourism makes it the only city in the world that could, until very recently, sustain several gay and queer milongas a week. Thus, many queer tango dancers are able to enjoy a rich tango practice without ever attending straight milongas. Although this segregation offers individual queer tango dancers benefits, such as relief from microaggressions, it doesn't promote integration between queer and straight tango dancers that occurs in other cities that don't have a distinct circuit of queer milongas. In Seattle, where I live, for example, the presence of openly gay and lesbian tango dancers crossing expected gender roles at the city's milongas has inspired many straight dancers to likewise experiment with open role dancing, which in turn helped to welcome more queer dancers into the scene as they saw same-sex dancing becoming more common. In contrast, I was struck by how little crossover existed between queer and straight tango circuits in Buenos Aires, especially among Argentines. For example, most women I saw leading at straight milongas admitted that although they were aware of gay and queer milongas, they never or rarely attended themselves. Despite the high visibility of Argentina's annual queer tango festival in the international queer tango community, Very few people attending mainstream milongas the week of the festival were even aware of its existence. During my fieldwork in 2012, I went to Tango Queer every Tuesday evening, and every Wednesday afternoon I attended La Maria, a role crossing practica, which founder Majo, Majo Marini began in 2009 for women to practice leading in reaction to laments about wallflowering from her female friends. Although Marini hypothesized that some attendees at her practica were homosexual, the event was not advertised as gay and drew a predominantly heterosexual crowd. Both La Maria and Tango Queer attracted a majority female clientele and were the two spaces where I met the highest concentration of female leaders. Although occasionally a tourist I met at one venue might appear at the other the next week, Argentines did not attend both events. The minimal overlap between patrons at these two venues is symptomatic of a deeper issue. Argentine and foreign women are judged by different standards. Whereas foreign women who lead are accepted at most milongas in Buenos Aires without needing to declare or qualify their sexual orientation, many Argentine women believe that their own leading will be interpreted as a marker of homosexuality. As explained by an Argentine professional dancer.
Argentina, el rol está determinado por la inclinación sexual. O sea, las mujeres que bailan de varón, si son argentinas, están determinadamente definidas en su sexualidad. En cambio, en el extranjero, no.
Her suggestion that Argentine women who lead will be assumed to be homosexual helps to explain a common reaction to my request for interviews at La Maria. When I explained to women that I wanted to interview them for a project about women who dance with other women, many protested, "Pero no bailo con mujeres." But I don't dance with women, after I just witnessed them executing ocho, sacadas, and baleos in the arms of another woman. Reminiscent of the way it is explained that men in the early 20th century were just practicing with other men, many Porteña women were hesitant to call executing tango steps in the arms of another woman dancing. Their need to maintain a clear distinction between practicing for academic study and social dancing for pleasure exposes both a persistent homophobia as well as privileges foreign women enjoy to violate codes of gendered behavior with more impunity than locals. Although many informants described how difficult it was for dancers outside the queer tango scene to believe that a straight woman might dance with another woman for pleasure, almost all Argentines accepted studying the leader's role as part of their training to teach as a valid reason for women to dance together. Even people who voiced disapproval of female leaders made exceptions for professional tango teachers. In a country that has been in economic crisis for decades, where inflation is so high that citizens prefer in dollars rather than banks or local currency, everyone accepts that customs must shift in the face of economic necessity. Women in Argentina work, and for tango teachers, this means that they must learn and practice the man's role. Given that thousands of Argentines are pursuing careers as tango teachers, the professional exception is a big loophole. Through this entry point, many Argentine women have discovered pleasure in leading. For example, one dancer explained after beginning to lead in order to help her partner and her students, she began to discover pleasure and power in the role itself.
Al principio te digo, fue una necesidad porque en las clases siempre había más mujeres que hombres. Entonces, con mi compañero, que era mi esposo, en ese momento, nosotros enseñábamos. Y él no podía bailar con todas las mujeres. Entonces, yo me vi no obligada en ese momento, me vi con la necesidad de ayudarlo. Entonces al principio fue una necesidad de laborar. Y después dije, wow, todo lo que puedo hacer. Y se abrió un mundo.
Likewise, Soledad Nani's partner, Shushu Herrera, who had little interest in the leader's role until she became a teacher, explains the multitude of ways she is now fulfilled by dancing the leader's role.
Hoy en día, para resumirte, además de cuestiones de necesidad de tipo de laboral, yo quiero bailar el rol masculino para completarme, para conocer y sobre todo para tener más poder. O sea, para empoderarme. mujeres. Y en ese empoderamiento, no solo una de las retribuciones que puedo obtener es un placer desconocido para mí, porque puedo tener placer bailando mi rol femenino, ¿sí? Atreverme a tener el otro placer, que es distinto, no es igual, ¿no? Y también dar placer desde este lugar, que es distinto, ¿no? Entonces, por razones ideológicas, por razones feministas, por razones políticas, por razones sociales, físicas, culturales, laborales y emocionales, es que yo bailo y quiero bailar el rol masculino.
The empowerment Herrera identifies as a result of dancing the leader's role extends far beyond the professional realm to enrich her social practice. Herrera enjoys dancing the leader's role and giving pleasure to other women from that position. The succulent dishes of lovingly arranged caminadas, cruzadas, and pasadas she serves her female partners work to slowly destabilize tango's gendered hierarchy. Maintenance of queer tango spaces offer valuable benefits to their participants, so I'm reluctant to advocate for total integration of queer tango into straight tango communities. However, Argentina's steady economic deterioration over the last decade may produce such an integration in Buenos Aires. Decreased purchasing power of the dollar and euro due to runaway inflation has led to a sharp decline in tourism, and specifically tango tourism, upon which the Milonga circuit depends. Tango commerce is suffering as a result of these economic pressures, but the queer milongas disproportionately so. In May of 2018, both La Marshall and Tango Queer, Buenos Aires gay and queer weekly milongas, closed their doors indefinitely. While both organizers cited inflation as the primary factor in suspension of their longstanding milongas, I can't help wondering if they have become casualties of their own success. As more and more same-sex couples nurtured and supported by the queer milonga circuit have felt comfortable dancing together in mainstream milongas, the demand for queer milongas has declined. Although some queer tango advocates would argue that elimination of the need for queer-specific milongas due to mainstreaming of same-sex tango is a mark of queer tango's ultimate success, I fear the closure of these spaces may have come too soon. During my fieldwork in Buenos Aires, I met 5 other ethnographers from 4 different countries researching queer tango. There were evenings at Tango Queer when the ethnographer to participant ratio was 1 to 5. As I struggled to make sense of the international attention queer tango was receiving, which seemed disproportionate to the number of practitioners it attracted, I began to wonder if queer tango is important as much for what it reveals about global desires about gender as for what sense queer tango dancers themselves make out of its practice. Is the fascination with queer tango a reflection of a collective desire to theorize our way out of a gender binary world? Even if queer tango's imagined dissolution of gender binaries is not realized on the dance floor, perhaps fostering belief in that utopic future is the central work of queer tango space. Taking inspiration from performance studies scholar Jose Munoz's proposal that we are not yet queer, and that, quote, queerness is a structuring and educated mode of desiring that allows us to see and feel beyond the quagmire of the present, to think and feel a then and there, end quote. Perhaps queer tango's unrealized gender utopia is the then and there that gives us hope in the here and now. Maybe it is not necessary to believe that a gender-free society is realistic or even possible in order for the ideal of such a gender-free utopia to be useful. After spending several months in queer tango spaces, physical as well as cyber and psychic, I can now guess what may have motivated the mischievous smiles of friends who insisted that queer milongas are different from common milongas. Queer tango spaces meet certain needs of many patrons in ways that straight milongas fail to do. Queer tango spaces offer queer dancers relief from minority stress and produce opportunities for gay and straight dancers to enjoy same-sex sexual potentiality. Queer tango spaces encourage experiments in furthering new tango techniques that are less dialogic and, or more dialogic and less dictatorial, giving women in particular more voice in the partnership. And perhaps most crucial of all, queer tango spaces are vital for testing out, wrestling with, and theorizing gender utopias. Thank you. And now we have time for discussion.
We do. We just need to wait for the roving microphone. And don't forget, as always, you need to speak into it because that's how the people who are remote can hear us. Everyone else in the room, I think, just hears us. All right, so does... Oh,
there's a question.
Sorry, let me...
Cheryl, there's a question here on the floor.
Already. Okay, thank you. Sorry.
Or a comment.
Okay, so I missed the first 5 minutes, so you may have already answered this. But I'm thinking, okay, so there's this fluidity between the one who leads and the one who follows, but there's still this identification of leadership with a male role. This person performs the male, this person performs the male role. So is it really disrupting the binary? That's one thing. And secondly, is it changing the dancing itself? I mean, it seems to be a style that needs a leader-follower no matter what the exchange is of the roles, but is the dancing actually changing at all because of queering the tango? So those two things. One, is it really disrupting the binary or is that still defining it? And secondly, is the dancing itself changing because of the queering?
Yeah, those are actually the sort of the fundamental challenges that I think the queer circuit is always struggling with. And there's actually quite a bit of public scholarship by people who aren't even scholars, trained in academic scholarship, who are doing this work. And I think that it's really hard to get out of the binary in this dance. And often in Argentina, they're sort of changing the language. Because they don't even, if they use leader and follow, they borrow the English term sometimes, like leader. But so they're trying to change the language to like driver and driven. There's like this, which doesn't sound so good in English, right? Sounds better in Spanish. But it's like, but I think the way I think Mariana, who runs Tango Queer, feels like she's shifting that binary is that she really encourages everyone to do both roles. So it's not like you just do one role and that people switch off. And there's some discussion, like there's this moment of the intercambio where you change roles in the middle of the dance, and there's an embrace you can do that is sort of symmetric so that at any moment anybody could take over leading and you don't quite know when it's going to happen. But the tango is such a hard dance that it takes so much practice to get even good at one role that to have people who are skilled enough at both roles to do that, like changing of the roles in the middle, is so rare. So it's a big struggle. But in terms of how, if the technique of the dance is changing, sort of I described a little bit like the way Soledad Nani follows, which is to constantly disrupt the lead and change what's going on. And that exists outside of queer tango, for sure. But it's more common, it's more encouraged in queer tango. So I think queer tango advocates think that, you know, more of that is maybe shifting the dance. But there's a lot to be thought through on that. And I don't know if anyone else who dances tango wants to comment on that, because I know there's more tango dancers in the room.
I have another question. Okay, so again, I came in late, so knowing that tango starts, as you said, with the males in the beginning, historically with males practicing with one another, has, again, queering tango opened up space for male-male dancing in a way that
I'm so glad you asked, because I sort of, you know, skipped over that part because I had a lot to fit in. So the reason I focused on women is partly because I'm a woman, and so I felt like I had easier access to build bonds with women, to talk to them, and I'm a woman who dances with other women. So, and the international queer tango circuit is 90% women. In Buenos Aires, it's not quite so skewed. It's maybe 50-50, but outside of Argentina, it's mostly women who participate, which is why I decided to focus on women. But there certainly are men dancing together. I just flew here from the San Francisco Tango Marathon, which is a
pretty straight marathon, although it is in San Francisco. Like, it's 450 people, and I would say at any moment, I would see, like, 3 to 5 female-female couples on the floor during the course of the marathon at any given moment. So there were a fair number of women leading each other. But there was one man there who was wearing heels half the time and dancing with men. And there were few men. So it's starting to happen. It's just much slower to making space for men to feel more comfortable dancing together.
Thank you so much for that presentation, Julia. It was absolutely wonderful. And I wanted to ask something you mentioned quite early on. You referenced the male gaze. And then I think one of your interviewees mentioned something about staring and daily life. And I was thinking, watching you dance with both partners, you danced with your eyes closed. Everyone seemed to dance with their eyes closed, and I know also in tango the gaze has really dropped. And I'm wondering if there's something inherent to the execution of the dance that sort of resists those gendered structures of looking through either having the eyes closed while dancing or keeping the gaze really down. I appreciate people watching it from the outside or looking, but I was just wondering if there's something about it in a way that not all social, I'm trying to think through other social dances that, you know, not that many of them seem to have eyes closed, you're so sort of close to your partner, and it seems like there's often a sort of downward focus that sort of resists some of those gender structures of looking.
Well, when you're dancing, first of all, you're too close to look at your partner. Your eyes would get crossed. And you're trying to foster this internal state of being. You want to be like inside yourself and maybe even inside like the skin of your partner. So it's not at all about looking, except the leader has to, I should not close my eyes when I'm leading because I have to guide us to not crash into other people. But there's still, the gaze is super important in the social structure of the dance because it's not something that you do in a room by yourself. You do it in a room with other people, and everyone's looking first to figure out who they're going to choose to dance with next. So you're kind of aware people are looking at you all the time. And then the whole contract to dance is established through gazing. So I think it's pretty gendered in that way. Like, the women are so presenting themselves in a way to be consumed in terms of how they're dressed, like, you know, emphasizing the butt and the breast. And I mean, this, like, these like sort of fetishized like reenactments of golden age tango milongas where the women are seated on one side and the men are on the other. It's like this fantasy of what the golden age was like. And the women are all lined up like Shushu said, like with like rotisserie chickens, like with their breasts plumped up waiting to be selected. And then the men are sitting on the other side and you have to wait for some man. And then you have to like sit in your seat and make sure he wanted you exactly. I mean, there's a lot of really gendered gazing around the dance.
Sure, but I guess what I'm also asking in that case, is there any different kind of operations? I mean, the whole idea of the male gaze is somewhat problematic anyway because it doesn't account for other kinds of subject position. So I think the idea of the male gaze is somewhat problematic anyway, but I'm wondering if there's something about the operation of the gaze in queer tango spaces is distinct from this heteronormative milongas.
Absolutely. Yes, that is true, because you can't just assume by looking what role anybody does, who they want to dance with. So that does really, and something about the dress really disrupts that too in the queer spaces.
Yeah. Okay. I'd like to follow up on that because I dance tango and I consider myself a very ardent feminist as well, and I still haven't sorted out how to reconcile that. And I think a lot about what is the appeal of this very, it's not a sexual, but I think there's a gender thing about the performance of roles that is why tango speaks to me. So have you, and I've talked about it with my women friends too, why
who are we dressing up for? But we take a lot of pleasure in it, you know, in the shoes and in the whole performing a certain kind of femininity that is very old, and it's a space, the traditional milonga is a place where we do, women in particular, I think far more than men, do perform this femininity that most of us don't do when we're outside the milonga. So have you thought much about the appeal, that particular, the basis for why we do, why we go through these rituals of performing that that kind of femininity? Maybe the other tango women here would have something to say about it. I don't have an answer, but I think about it.
I'd love to hear from somebody else before I answer, if somebody wants to answer that.
Well, I have a young son right now, and I just watch him and his friends constantly dressing up. And it doesn't matter what they're wearing. I think there's this, it's very pleasurable. I don't know, there's probably something more specific that's going on in tango, but I think that's a very human desire.
First of all, just thank you so much for a wonderful talk. Just in reference to your point, I'm wondering if there's some if there's something about the melodrama, and I'm almost hesitant to use that word because I wonder if that's from, you know, outside of the culture. Is it really melodramatic in the Argentinian context? I spent a lot of time in San Telmo as well, but I'm still not quite sure whether melodrama would be the correct term, but there's something, whether you are subverting or challenging those symbols at work, those exaggerated symbols at work in melodrama, or whether you're sort of celebrating them, it's sort of the, there's something about those exaggerated performativity that feels like sort of in the same moment, incredibly prescribed, but then also there's so much playfulness and the fact that it's so big, and that the performance of the femininity or the masculinity is so big it sort of makes the performance itself, the fact that it is performing and not essentializing, visible, if that makes sense. So I'm just wondering, you know, in terms of your expertise, whether melodrama is even a sort of relevant concept here.
Well, tango dancers pride themselves on their subtlety. Like it's very much about subtlety in the social practice. Now, the stage form of tango, tango escenario, is all about melodrama, but that's quite distinct from the social practice in the milongas. It's an interesting concept. You all have very generous interpretations of the phenomenon. I have a more pessimistic thought, but it could, you know, be more about me. I think initially a lot of women find a lot of joy in the in performing the feminine and this feminine role of, oh my gosh, like, especially women who are like strong, high-powered women who have like high-powered careers, like enjoy this relief from that pressure and this pleasure in playing this feminine role that often, even through a feminist identity, they feel like they can't even admit that they have some pleasure in it. Right, and I don't think there's anything wrong with having pleasure in it, but I think a lot of women in tango get sort of caught in the cycle where you have to dress up and perform this in order to get selected, and there's a bias for youth, and there's bias for a certain kind of beauty, and you have to sort of play these games more in order to sort of get the pleasure that you want to get out of the dance. And I think there's some, it's quite problematic in that way. And I think there's also a need amongst people in North America and Europe in particular to sort of say, oh, we have to perform this way because it's this Argentine tradition. So they're not owning their own need for performing this feminine role and enjoying it and saying, oh no, we're actually performing this other cultural tradition. And I think Argentines, to a certain extent, are then auto exoticizing their own culture in order to appeal to the foreigners, because that's where all the money is. That's quite more pessimistic.
Thank you.
Thank you. Wonderful speech. I am curious if you've seen this as opening a door for other social dances to have queer spaces, especially the Latin American dances, merengue, salsa, bachata, or do you find it easier because it's European connection in Argentina and it's closer, just because it's Argentina versus other Latin American countries?
Yeah. It is quite quite interesting that of all of the social dance communities that have been cosmopolitanized, like salsa and swing, and you know even newer ones like souk and kizomba, it's tango that has the most queer activity for sure. And you know, I could hypothesize as to why that is. I mean, part of it has to do with the people who are drawn to tango tend to have higher level of education, so they tend to be sort of engaged in these intellectual discourses around gender. Maybe that's it. I don't know. I'm trying to start some dialogue in Seattle around this, and I'm trying to create. What I'm trying to do is open a not a queer salsa space, but an open role salsa space, which to me is distinct, because I want to actually encourage. I want queer people to feel comfortable, but I want to encourage everyone to be trying both roles and to see how that shifts the dance. And so, it's slow. But yeah, I'm all for other people working on that, please.
I'm gonna ask a question. I'm wondering what you would attribute the kind of feeling of comfort or freedom to in these spaces, given that the kind of codes of, you know, asking and rejecting or accepting a dance and the kind of the repercussions of dancing with someone, and you know, the possibility of forming relationships or sexual encounters or whatever is present there too. Those things to me might also lead to a certain kind of, I don't know, anxiety. I'm wondering if the freedom that people feel there is more, like, why they feel that way, you know, is it just because the roles are uncertain and you don't know when you're going to be following or leading, or what the person you're asking to dance is going to do, or, you know, what?
Yeah, I mean, I think that's part of it, but queer tango spaces, they're very modern. In the way that other tango spaces are performing this reenactment of this dance from this golden age. And there's even like at this club, they have this list of the códigos on a wall in like eight languages of like, don't walk backwards, make sure you use the cabeceo. Like people are really trying to like control this sort of idea of what tango is based on this fantasy of history. And the queer tango spaces are saying, no, we are actually pioneering something new. And so the dress is way more casual and varied. They, tango queer, in which is, I'm so devastated is closed, they would play, so the tradition in tango is between each tanda, you play a cortina, which is like a little snippet of another music so people can change partners. They play a whole song during the cortina, and people will get up and dance cumbia or salsa or some swing or some happy rhythm, right? So there's like all of this much more joy going on because they're sort of creating the space, and the, you know, people who are created and hold a queer tango space are holding a space where everyone feels welcome. So I think that gives everybody, regardless of their sexual orientation, this sort of feeling of like, there's some like, oh, there's a feeling of acceptance here. Like, I remember seeing a performance of tango by a group of children with Down syndrome at a queer milonga. And I was like, well, why is this here? And the organizers are like, because we're really trying to support like anybody doing tango in any way. Like we are the we are holding that space. Everybody really feels that.
You sort of beautifully described tango queer as an almost, or it sounded really utopian to me, this kind of somewhat utopian space. And I just want to ask a little bit about whether through your ethnographic research you found sort of dissenting voices. So I was thinking, you know, is there anything from the sort of straight male community whereby the sort of anxieties around what's happening in queer tango? Or I was thinking, or sort of a broader homophobia, or even I was thinking, sometime in some areas of the queer community, I know there can be some tensions around bisexual positioning, in that it seems to be both an opportunity to sort of transgress and to maintain sort of dominant power relations. So I'm just wondering if there's any sort of dissenting voices that you've sort of come across within the broader setting within Buenos Aires.
Well, sure, there's always people who are saying women shouldn't lead, women shouldn't be dancing together, women should be dancing with men. But they're doing it less publicly. And a lot of that had to do with, you know, that Argentina legalized gay marriage in 2010. Mm-hmm. And there was just enormous pressure for people to, legal pressure, to not be seen as discriminatory. That doesn't mean they're still not thinking it, right? But they're less overt about it. Mm-hmm. I think the things that I heard, the more dissenting voices I heard, were from women who dance with other women who don't go to queer dances because they're like, the level of dancing is so low. I don't want to go there, mm-hmm. right? And that's where it's not utopic, right? Mm-hmm. Because in order for it to be welcoming to everybody, there's a huge range of levels there. And tango dancers want to dance with the best dancers they can.
We are done. I just want to take this opportunity to say thank you so much for such a wonderful and nuanced presentation. Thank you for the dancing as well. Thank you, Julie.
Thank you all for coming. And I'm really curious if you have other comments or questions to come up and share them with me. I'd be really curious to hear. It was not a very theoretical presentation because I wanted to give voice to these people that I talked to. Mm-hmm.